freedom. Oh, freedom.
Oh, freedom is the cornerstone upon which Americans built their lives and this nation. Denied this fundamental right, African Americans undertook a quest for freedom that continues today. This region has been both a destination for freedom seekers and a center for abolitionists and activists working against slavery and for civil rights. Not until the end of the Civil War in 1865 did many of the issues of slavery, citizenship, and suffrage resolve into a new world for African Americans. From the anti-slavery movement through the civil rights to today, African Americans have helped define freedom and shape the American experience.
Freedom over me, yeah.
And before I be a slave, I'll be buried.
As the cradle of civilization, Africa has a long history. The people of Africa flourished for centuries before the slave trade began. From the 14th to 18th centuries, major empires, kingdoms, and chiefdoms evolved and their people advanced language, art, agriculture, technology, and science. The great natural and human wealth of the continent of Africa encouraged numerous societies to flourish. Enslaved Africans, the trip across the Atlantic was a one-way journey from freedom to a lifetime of servitude. From 1525 to 1867, European slave ships delivered more than 12 million African men, women, and children into slavery in the Americas. Often called the triangular trade, the enslaved were brought here to produce crops, mine precious minerals, or make goods that Europeans used to trade for more slaves in Africa. Chattel slavery defined Africans as property without human rights and enforced racism as a way to prevent African freedom and maintain European superiority. Slavery transformed life in Africa, Europe, and the Americas. The slave ship became the most important machine in the growth of the slave trade. Merchant and secondhand ships were reconstructed as floating prisons, fitted specifically for the transport of hundreds of Africans across the Atlantic Ocean. The vessels brought goods to trade for humans and food to feed the captain and crew on the voyage to Africa. Weighing hundreds of tons, the ships carried up to 1,000 captives crammed into the hull. Six and a half million people came to the Americas between 1492 and 1776. 1 million came from Europe, most by choice, seeking a better life or freedom from oppression. 5.5 million came from Africa, most in chains.
Day we started to fight.
The enslavement of Africans in the Americas contributed to the birth of the Industrial Revolution, the establishment of new nations, and a change in the status of old states. European and colonial governments and agencies made millions off the trade, fueling the growth of industrial and financial economies. During the slave trade, the Dutch West India Company, chartered in 1621, became one of the first global corporations. New world economies based on sugar, rice, cotton and tobacco production, and mining of gold, silver, copper, and coal and iron created the demand for slave labor and globalized trade. In North America, plantation agriculture, mining, shipping, insurance, and banking all profited from slavery, allowing slaveholders and their collaborators to build great wealth.
Is the chain from hand to hand. Keep your eyes on the prize of my hold on.
Sugarcane, or white gold, as British colonists called it, became the most profitable cash crop of the New World, plantation economy. During the 17th and 18th centuries, the demand in Europe for sugar rose dramatically. As coffee became popular, sugar became the sweetener of choice. The juice of the cane was processed into sugar, molasses, or rum, and sold in European markets, generating huge profits for investors. A tough plant to cultivate, harvest, and process, it took thousands of enslaved to produce sugarcane. The conditions and climate in the tropics and in South Carolina and Louisiana made the work laborious and dangerous. This is a fulcrum shovel used for centuries in Guinea coastal rice farming. It has a long shaft and flattened head. Rice has been grown since 300 BC in West Africa's Guinea coast area from the Serengambia region to Liberia. Used as a food on board slave ships crossing the Atlantic, rice also became the major starchy food of colonial America. As colonists invested in growing rice, the expertise and skill of African rice growers became vital in South Carolina and Georgia. Planters, and they were enslaved on rice plantations in the American South. A major slave market located in Charleston, South Carolina, specialized in the sale of African rice growers, exploited for their knowledge and for profit.
Oh, see those children dressed in black.
God's gonna trouble the world.
Even though the United States joined Great Britain and abolished the transatlantic slave trade in 1808, slavery did not disappear, nor was it seriously threatened. U.S. slave markets shifted their focus away from the importation of slaves, and Virginia became a leading slave supplier for the expanding southern market. Cotton, sugar, corn, and cattle plantations need enslaved labor to sustain and grow their production. Slave dealers in Alexandria, Virginia, made millions of dollars supplying the slave markets of New Orleans, Louisiana, and Natchez, Mississippi. The Franklin Armfield Company, operating in Alexandria from 1828 to 1841, became one of the leading slave dealers.
Those children dressed in red, my God,
he's gonna trouble the water.
You know it must be the children that Moses led, my God,
he's gonna trouble the water.
Dressed in green,
God's gonna trouble the water.
cotton became king, the most profitable cash crop in America, from 1800 through the Civil War. The invention of the cotton gin, a machine which made the dangerous and laborious process of removing the bulb from the husk easier and faster, revolutionized the cotton industry and greatly enhanced the power and wealth of cotton plantation owners. By the 1840s, cotton accounted for nearly half the economic growth of the United States. Deeply invested in the cotton industry, Allegheny County textile mills imported tons of Mississippi-grown cotton each year. The Eagle Cotton Mill, Hope Cotton Works, Anchor Cotton Mill, Globe Factory, and the Phoenix Cotton Factory helped make this region a major textile center.
But one God made us all.
Self-liberation became the most common form of resistance to slavery. Enslaved Africans and African Americans who sought to free themselves by running away are called freedom seekers. No one knows exactly how many African Americans liberated themselves from slavery, but from the 1780s through the 1860s, thousands pursued freedom by heading north, west, or south to the Caribbean and Mexico. They escaped as individuals, in groups, or with their families, often seeking freedom with no network of support or aid. The choice to escape bondage was not an easy one. It often separated families and put freedom seekers in harm's way. But the desire for liberty was strong. Freedom seekers who settled in Pittsburgh brought their culinary traditions with them, giving the region a diverse pot of ethnic flavors. African traditions in food choice, preparation, cooking, serving, and nutrition adapted to the conditions of slavery, where the enslaved had to make do with readily available, cheap ingredients. This resulted in the development of a cuisine now called soul food, with all its regional and ethnic variations. The typical diet for most enslaved consisted of rice, corn, greens, and animal fat or meat, supplemented by what they could grow in small gardens. They often fished and hunted small game as well.
Well, some say John was a Baptist. Some say John was a Jew. But I say John was a preacher, cause my Bible says so too. I say roll.
Born in Virginia to slave laborers in 1827, Abel Bogus dreamed of freedom. Fearing the repercussions after his master died in 1843, Abel, his mother, and five younger siblings fled the plantation and headed north. The first night they traveled about 15 miles, seeking refuge in the woods and on a high summit. After two nights, Abel's mother and sister returned to the plantation while he set off on the long and dangerous trip for that haven where slavery was unknown. A week later, he reached Uniontown, PA, aided by agents on the Underground Railroad. From there, he traveled on horseback to the smoky city of Pittsburgh, where John Vashon and Thomas McKeever kept him safe for 3 days before sending him on to Butler, PA. Though Abe intended to head for Canada, he settled in northern Ohio, living with a benefactor, A.K. Garlick, who enrolled him in school. Abel took Garlick's last name and used his own nickname, Charlie. Later in life, Charlie penned his story of escape, the fear of capture, the near misses with slave hunters while visiting Butler County, his time at Oberlin College, and his service during the Civil War. Garlick's story remains one of the few first-person accounts of a runaway, hinting at the danger and hardship, but also telling of the success of our journey to the land of liberty for the slave. For many enslaved, the journey to freedom started with the difficult choice of who to take and who to leave behind. Charity twice made the journey. The first time she took her four small children and fled to a place near Greenwich, New Jersey, to be with her husband who had purchased his freedom. Pursued by slave hunters, she was captured and returned to bondage in Maryland. Freedom seekers who traveled in the western Pennsylvania had to traverse the Allegheny Mountains and avoid slave catchers on the trail. Confronted with hunger, sickness, and trauma, many turned to the natural environment for shelter, sustenance, support, and medicine. As they made their way north, freedom seekers encountered at least 50 species of wild plants that could be used for food or medicine. Survival meant understanding the seasonality of plants, their toxicity, and how to best prepare and utilize them.
Under the operation of this bill, too, no colored person can be safe. who is to judge whether he is free or a bondsman? Who is there to swear that I was not a slave? To a colored man, this is an impossibility. Here then am I, a free man, liable any time to be taken away and kept forever in bondage. Never fear, some will say that free papers we carry, but I will never carry parchment in my pocket to prove that I am a man. Honorable Mayor, whatever ideas of liberty I may have been received from reading the lives of your revolutionary fathers. I have therein learned that a man has a right to defend his castle with his life, even unto the taking of life. Sir, my home is my castle. In that castle are none but my wife and my children, as free as the angels of heaven, and whose liberty is as sacred as the pillars of God. If any approach the house in search of a slave, I care not who he may be, whether constable or sheriff, magistrate, or even judge of the Supreme Court. Nay, let it be he who sanctioned this act to become law, surrounded by his bodyguard, with the Declaration of Independence waving above his head as his banner, and the Constitution of this country upon his breast as a shield. If he crosses the threshold of my door and I do not lay him a lifeless corpse at my feet, I hope the grave will refuse my bodyguard's presence. And righteous heaven, my spirit, my home. No, he cannot enter that house. And both.
And hold on. Ooh. If you wanna get to heaven, I'll tell you. Keep your hand on that gospel plow. Keep your hand on that plow. Just hold on.
Hold that chain and never tie. Every round goes higher and higher. Keep your hand on that plow and hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on. Keep your hand on that plow. Just hold on.
In 1853, Ira Crow, a young British artist, visited a slave auction in Richmond, Virginia. Horrified by what he witnessed, he captured the scene in sketches that he later developed into a series of illustrations and paintings, including this one. Art and objects depicting the slave trade aided the cause of abolitionists. In 1780, the Pennsylvania legislature passed the Gradual Abolition Act, initiating the end of slavery in the Commonwealth. The act stated that enslaved people born before March 1, 1780 would remain slaves for life. Any children born to slaves after that date would serve as indentures until age 28. Slave and indenture holders had to register their people. In order to prevent free-born children, some slave owners took their pregnant slaves to slave-holding states such as Maryland and Virginia and Delaware to give birth. In Allegheny County, records of manumission, freedom certificates, and indentures were filed to document the status of African Americans. The records show that slavery existed in Pennsylvania in one form or another until the 1850s.
Oh, I'll be a slave. I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. Oh, freedom.
Without these papers filed at the Allegheny County Deeds Office between 1792 and 1857, even free blacks ran the risk of being enslaved. Emancipation is the setting free of an enslaved person by legal means. The emancipated were set free by their slave owners, but also more commonly by an act of law, such as the Emancipation Proclamation or a state statute. Before the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, African Americans were not considered citizens and had few legal rights. Certificates of freedom served as legal documents verifying the free status of a person.
And before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my own grave and go home to my Lord and be free.
Oh, freer.
The region had a vocal, organized population of free African Americans that advocated for an end to slavery and equal rights for all. Institutions in the community, such as churches, supported this activity. Abolitionists also founded activist organizations and aligned themselves with national groups to work for freedom. The Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 had a major impact on the region. More than half of Allegheny County's African-American population moved north to Canada or west to safety, while others revisited the idea of emigration. The county also sent the largest delegation to the National Emigration Convention in Cleveland, Ohio in 1854, where Pittsburgh was named as the headquarters for the organization and host to the Board of National Commissioners.
Went down to the River Jordan, where John baptized three. When I walked the devil in hell, says Johnny, baptized me. I say, roll, Jordan, roll. Oh, now I'm roll, Jordan, roll. My soul will rise to heaven, Lord, for the year, Jordan, roll. Well, some say John was a Baptist. Some say John was a Jew. But I say John was a preacher, cause my Bible says so too. I say,
located south of Pittsburgh and sharing a border with the slaveholding state of Virginia, Washington County became a key to the abolitionist movement. A branch of the Anti-Slavery Society formed there in 1834, sought immediate emancipation for enslaved Africans. Founding member Dr. Francis Lemoyne became president of the society in 1835 and a vocal activist for human rights. Vital to the anti-slavery movement, newspapers debated and publicized the abolitionist message, sharing stories of the horrors of slavery. Many of the abolitionist newspapers began publishing in the 1830s. The papers built support and gained political allies in Congress and at the state level. They also became a conduit to share news in the African-American community and educate all readers on important issues of the day. The abolishment of slavery in the United States took many years and proved challenging. As freedom seekers traveled north, they relied upon a network of people in western Pennsylvania to help them make their way to liberty. Operating in secret, this network of abolitionists provided freedom seekers with food, clothing, shelter, transport, and work. In Pittsburgh, free blacks and whites also formed numerous organizations to fight for freedom. The heated debate on slavery and the fact that not all anti-slavery advocates spoke with a single voice led to the founding of competing organizations with differing ideas. Abolitionist newspapers shared information about the debate and the movements, educating and organizing readers for the cause. Activists supported freedom seekers on the journey and traveled the North, speaking out for change. Slavery brought the nation to civil war. Eager to fight for freedom, Pittsburgh men joined the Union cause. In 1861, two African-American militia units, the Fort Pitt Cadets and the Hannibal Guards, volunteered to serve and were denied. African-Americans did serve in Company 1, 12th Pennsylvania Volunteers, from April to August 1861. On January 1st, 1863, President Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. The executive order freed the enslaved living in the states that had seceded from the Union and established the United States Colored Troops, a unit of cavalry and infantry soldiers in the Federal Army. There were 8,612 African Americans from Pennsylvania who served in the Union Army. Hundreds of Pittsburgh men served in various units, including the Massachusetts 54th and 55th Regiments.
To pick a new name to mark your freedom.
Paratum.
Early in the morning, before the sun begins to shine, we're gonna start moving towards that separation.
Pennsylvania troops trained and mustered into the Army at Camp William Penn near Philadelphia and belonged to regiments which fought at New Market Heights, Fort Wagner, Richmond, Petersburg, and Appomattox. The larger African-American community supported these troops as they volunteered for service, trained for war, built fortifications, and fought for freedom.
So I'm gonna stand up. Take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, can you hear freedom calling? Calling me to answer. Gonna keep on keeping on.
Harriet, welcome to the Underground Railroad.
African Americans faced the challenge of a new America in the period after the Civil War. Nearly 4 million former enslaved now called themselves free. Thousands searched for decades to find family members separated during slavery. Restrictive black codes limited liberty and brought a new form of oppression. Many migrated to the North, seeking a better life outside the Jim Crow South. From 1870 to 1900, the African American population in Allegheny County grew from 4,549 to more than 20,000. African-American-owned businesses and agencies supported the growing community, while skilled iron and steel workers vied for jobs in local mills. The horrors of lynch mobs and disenfranchisement existed in western Pennsylvania as well as the South. Restrictions in public life limited access to housing, education, and jobs, and demeaned African-Americans. Even under these conditions, African Americans established churches, businesses, clubs, agencies, and organizations to strengthen their communities and make freedom a reality. New hope blossomed for African Americans as they streamed north in the early 20th century. In Allegheny County, the African American population more than doubled between 1910 and 1930 to 83,326. This population growth led to housing shortages, unemployment, and discrimination. Editorials in the Pittsburgh Courier newspaper, founded in 1910, trumpeted the cause for civil rights. The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, established in 1915 to protest the film Birth of a Nation, took on the cause of equality. Formed in 1918, the Urban League assisted African American workers in making their transition to life in the industrial city. Service in World War I initiated a new discussion on democracy as African Americans worked for greater political, social, and economic rights. 100 years after the Civil War began, African Americans fought a new battle for equality, as many civil rights, including voting rights, continue to be denied. In Pittsburgh, people battled for access to public accommodations and jobs. Many of the downtown department stores had restrictions on African American shoppers, and public construction projects did not hire African American tradesmen. Reminiscent of the movement to abolish slavery 100 years before, national civil rights organizations actively addressed discrimination in American society. Let freedom reign. The sun never set on so glorious a human achievement. Nelson Mandela.
Take my people with me.